Okay, we are having a an interview to this evening is Monday, January the 13th. It's a quarter past 7 Eastern time, and I am speaking with Joachim Hagopian, who doesn't live in the US, thank goodness for him, who I've interviewed many times before because I'm extremely grateful for the work that he does on child abuse, and especially well, again, it's not really a recent subject. It's been kind of going on for quite a while, even though more people are speaking about it more and more lately. And so, like, what I wanted to do, because I mean, I haven't been really doing interviews. I mean, I was doing things for people's internet radio, and you know, I guess I was running out of motivation and feeling like it, you know, I was just not getting like the support, just views wise and money wise or whatever, you know. So I was like, why should I bother? So then I just kind of made my own video blogs, just literally talking about the micro and the macro. I mean, that's literally all I talk about is, 'cause you know, everything that I lived and experienced, studied all my life, you know, child abuse, abusive relationships, the abusive and just dysfunctional relationships, and even in the workplace, you know, it's just like now it is literally the same exact thing on a macro scale, and yet the micro level and how, in my experience, I mean, I lived it, and saw firsthand for decades how the people, and it was so clear to me. I don't know how people just didn't want to see it, didn't see it, whatever. How the people have been and are just so conditioned, and they are completely unconscious to how they are the ones who carry out and do the bidding of the abusers in power at their own expense. And it was just something that I tried to, you know, teach people. I mean, it's always been right in front of people's faces. Right, I mean, you know, and yet today, you know, we talk about things on these mass scales, you know, Trump this and Trump that and endless wars and you know, now it's a threat with war with Iran and Jeffrey Epstein and all of these larger version, you know, but if I feel like, and I've always felt this way, that if we don't, you know, focus on the micro, the scale down, and people, right, like look at themselves and how, and you know, look in your own backyard, like bring things, you know, work on the people and things that are right around you and the people that are right in front of you. Like that's how, you know, we take on the mass scale things. So again, like I've interviewed you about pedophilia and some dark things, and so you were just right. Talk about you're making a book, and it's a million words, you said. You talk about
Yeah.
what you've been focusing on lately.
Sure. Okay, well, I started it way back in April of 27, no, 18, 2018. And no, actually 2017. It's coming up on 3 years in April. This April will be, which is only 3 months away, it will be 3 years that I've been working every day on this mammoth, bigger than the Bible, book. It is the A through Z source book encyclopedia of modern pedophilia, and it's called Pedophilia and Empire, Satan, Sodomy, and the Deep State. I take the macro view. I'll talk a little of my past. I'm a West Point graduate. I learned very early on that I'm not a robot and I will not be programmed, and I have a mind of my own. And so I immediately, of course, clashed in the military. So much for the legacy of trying to follow in your father's footsteps, living out his dream, not mine. So I extricated myself from that, fortunately, and moved on to end up going back to school in psychology and became a licensed therapist, a marriage family therapist out in California for about 27 years. And I worked with children. I worked with victims of pedophilia. And so it gave me the understanding and the sensitivity and the passion to be able to take a look at the pedophilia in around the world and dissect it and make it understandable to the average citizen and wake our human species up, because there is a relative handful of planetary controllers from bloodline families that pretty much dictate and control every aspect of our life unless we extricate ourselves and take a look at ourselves in the mirror. There is that micro of taking your own crap and trying to sort it out and become halfway healthy human being, as well as the process of realizing that we are not pawns, we are not robots, and we do not have to choose to be programmed, automatons, unthinking, having no clue about what's going on. We have to take responsibility as citizens of the world, that we as sovereign citizens of the world, that we are not going to be dictated, and we are not going to tolerate the large forces that do control this earth for annihilating, for in blood sacrifice ceremonies, ritualistic, all this adrenochrome drinking, organ eating. It's so, you know, it's the worst imaginable topic that you can take on, because most, quote, normal people, they can't wrap their head around this ugliness. It's just too much. And that's part of the problem, because if you just shy away from it because it's just too much for your sensitivity and sensibilities, so you run away, well, you're part of the problem too. Because there are 8 million kids estimated every year that go missing. 800,000 alone in the United States. So now a lot of them get, you know, found and get back home and all of that. But there's a rather considerable percentage that we don't know exactly that do disappear. They end up dead, or they end up sex slaves being trafficked, whether it's in your hometown, trafficked from one block to the next and sold, or whether they're being trafficked around the world. They often come from places like Asia and Africa, South America, and end up in Middle East, particularly Saudi Arabia or the United States or Canada or Europe or Australia. Global trafficking is a huge, huge problem. It's an epidemic, and it is the most lucrative, fastest growing organized crime trade in the world.
Yep.
It is the worst and most fastest growing and most profitable. You can sell a kid a half a dozen times a day, turn it over, and basically, when you do drugs, you sell it basically once. It goes from your hands to someone else. So there's a lot more money per commodity if you're dealing kids than you do in dealing drugs. So unfortunately, there's a lot of very sick, evil people that are a part of this whole enterprise.
Yeah.
But the thing is, my book is centered on the power structure that's behind it, that are the overlords that are responsible for the human trafficking trade of children and organs and drugs.
Can you talk about like exactly how, you know, how does it go? Like,
sure. Yeah.
Like who,
I can tell all about it.
Who exactly? Like,
I got 32 chapters, all about it already. Okay. Well, it is a government, enterprise. All the large governments of the world, Great Britain and the United States, Canada, all the Western powers are involved. I find that the Eastern nations are basically where a lot of children are abducted and trafficked from. Although there is a thing called pedophilia tourism, where they actually cater to the pedophiles, mostly from the West, of course, coming into Asia and other places in the world and doing things to kids in these, quote, exotic, fun time places. It's a real problem in Asia and Cambodia and Vietnam and Thailand. Thailand is one of the worst. Indonesia. It's a problem. The power structure. I have found that the intelligence services of the nations like America, which is the CIA, and then, of course, domestically, it's the FBI in the United States. But MI5, MI6, that's the domestic and international intelligence services of Britain. And then you have Mossad. Mossad plays a huge part. And of course, Jeffrey Epstein is perhaps a Mossad agent. He was an operative that was set up by the Zionists to basically get film footage on lots of big time people, celebrities, doing things to children, girls mostly, but also I'm sure boys. And he did a lot of trafficking from Eastern Europe in particular into the United States. He had, of course, his sex slave island, the Orgy Island on St. James in the Caribbean. And he also had the huge sprawling ranch in New Mexico. And, of course, the biggest mansion in New York City in Manhattan. And he had a place in Paris as well. So the guy was set up. You know, they called him an investment broker and all this, but no, he was set up from the very beginning. He became a multi-billionaire overnight because a guy named Wexler basically financed him. And Wexler is part of the mega group of Zionists that are part of the whole process of controlling the world for Israel. The Greater Israel Project, all the wars, they didn't have a Wexler report that they got. The U.S. government commissioned him to do a report on what we do in Iraq. And that was even prior to the invasion. So, I mean, he had his footprint in the Iraq war and Afghanistan and all of this. So we have these major players that are multi-billionaires that work with the governments and the intelligence services, and a lot of other players are involved. We also have child charities that are involved. A lot of the larger child charities work with as front companies for the CIA, and And basically, they're in the process of procuring babies. They get into adoptions, and it's a big, big trade. I finished a week or two ago, a chapter. I don't know, some people probably have heard of it, but there were the Hampstead 2. It was huge news on the internet back in 2015 and 16. It's kind of simmered down because the evil ones have gotten away with another scandal. So I'll just briefly touch on that because it's kind of a special one in that it directly involves a trafficking operation, MK Ultra mind controls involved, torture, and of course pedophilia. These two little kids, 8 and 9 years old, Gabriel 8 and his sister, geez, now I'm having a blank on her name. But anyway, and their mother, Ella Draper, now she goes by her Russian name, her maiden name, Gariba. And they ended up, while on vacation in North Africa, disclosing the abuse that their father, who is a cult, satanic cult leader in Hampstead, which is considered to be the wealthiest town in Britain. And it's in North London. It's multi-billionaires mostly live in this small little complex of a village or town. It's, you know, relative small population. I think 11,000 or something like that. But they're all rich. And in this little town, these two kids would go to school and their father would show up. And since they were toddlers, they had been sexually abused by this man. And he was the leader of a satanic cult. So while they were at school, they were being sodomized in orgy parties that the entire school just about, the teachers, there were 20 children who were involved in this, aside from the two Hampstead kids. And then there were teachers and their parents. They were all involved in this, basically this orgy, satanic ritual of abuse of these children. And they had contacts in this cult where they would recruit, basically provide a fresh supply of babies to be sacrificed. And these kids on camera, while they were on vacation in North Africa, in Morocco, explained all of this that they've been going through in very graphic terms. They come off, you know, enthusiastically just bringing it out like innocent kids, and they don't have the sad affect that someone who's normally horribly abused might have. But that was because, one, they're still very young, and two, they were so used to being abused that it comes off very matter-of-fact. They're very enthusiastic in wanting to get this information out to their mother and her boyfriend. And unfortunately, what happened was the boyfriend and Ella Gariba went back to Britain, and they... Abe Christie was the boyfriend, and he had a brother-in-law who was a metropolitan police sergeant. And so they immediately went to the sergeant and did video recordings with the sergeant, in addition to all the videos that they'd recorded while on vacation. And and so the sergeant immediately contacts the very next day his superiors in the police department, Metro Police, London. the largest, in, of course, in Britain. And what they did is they immediately went to his home the next morning and took his videos, both his recorded video and the visual. There was an audio recording that he took, and then they took the videos also. And then they put them in storage, and it was hush-hush from then on. The police department never did an investigation, although they did go through initial protocol where they had the children examined by a qualified doctor, a medical doctor. And the medical doctor found that there was lots of anal damage done to these children, okay? Done. It was like you can't even debate or question. There were objects that were, they called them willies, plastic willies, that are these dildos that would be pushed up their anuses every day, basically, by the father and the other cult members. And so there was physical damage. So anyway, the state decided, okay, we can't have this information come out. We have to immediately squelch it. So what they did is they turned on the mother and her boyfriend, and they said that they abused the children physically and coerced under physical abuse to make up all this stuff about this satanic cult. And so they twisted everything around and took the children away. Within a week, there were like several police interviews. The kids downloaded everything just like they did on the videos with the parents. And then they actually took the children away from their mother after about 1 week. And then slowly, basically, you know, deprived her of contact with her children. And they were moving in to basically lock her and her boyfriend, Abe Christie, up. And so they had to flee the country because their lives were in peril. And they ended up basically denying her parental rights of any contact. And basically they showcased this father who is the cult leader of this human trafficking operation in the richest community of Britain, and they put him on BBC, and they interview him, and it's just so nauseating because this guy's an actor also, by the way, and he's a bad actor. He has crocodile tears on this interview. It's just so sickening, and it's available. I have links in my chapter. But anyway, they make it like, oh, he's the poor martyr father. Oh, it's so terrible that they accused him of doing all these evil, sinful things, and he's just so innocent. It's nauseating. But anyway, they completely twisted everything around. However, nobody would know about this unless it wasn't Ella or Abe that uploaded the videos that they had while they were on vacation in Morocco. It was somebody, one of the campaign workers, they actually were getting some, quote, support. There are some, this is also a case in point of controlled opposition. There are people that are actually disinfo agents that work with an enemy, basically, in any kind of cause. And they've infiltrated the internet, saturating the internet with these shills. But anyway, they work actually as controlled opposition to basically they do smear campaigns on the whatever the cause is. It happened with Holly Grieg in Scotland, which is another chapter. And it happened. That's what they do. They have all the resources to basically carry on these operations against the truth coming out. They've gotten pretty good at it, actually.
I just wanted to, you know, because again, the reason why, like interviewing you. I mean, even though this stuff is really, not pleasant to hear, and you know, you don't want to believe that it's true and that it is happening. But you know, the way that I look at it, you know, because you know, since the 70s. People have made child abuse literally normal. Just your sort of like, I guess I'll just call it, you know, your average everyday, if you ask me, I think most people have been abused to some degree. The way that I studied things, anything less than children, people growing up and being raised to their full healthy potential, I consider to be abuse and should be considered to be abuse. And the fact that most people are just kind of brought up to, you know, just kind of have jobs and maintain the status quo and keep the psychos propped up, I mean, how can we not be living in what you're describing by you know, all these decades later? That's, you know, I mean, I just look at it like it's like simple math that when people function and make it normal that, you know, that they're here, you know, they're just workers and the psychos and the people in power are here, and that's the way it's supposed to be. I mean, people don't even see that as something is wrong with that. I mean, I mean, all my life, literally for decades, I was like almost like gasping at the sheer fact that people don't even realize that they themselves are supposed to be living to their healthy potential and, you know, challenging people in power, replacing people in power. They're supposed to be powerful themselves, you know. And I always thought if people didn't realize that that's how it's supposed to be, we have a really big problem on our hands.
Well, unfortunately, you know, the system is a brainwashed system. People are programmed, and they do not know that. I mean, we grow up thinking that we're living in a democracy and all of this. No. We have an oligarchy where there's a handful of people that we call our government, the Senate and the House, that are supposed to be representatives of the people. That's in the civics history books and all of this. But in reality, they answer to the corporations, basically. So it's a power structure that we're not taught in the school. And so there's everything is based on lies. All of our education system are lies. And the more credentials and letters you have next to your name in the education system, the more you are brainwashed. That's been my experience anyway. They dish out all these lies, whether it's history or whether it's politics or whether it's science. There's so many lies out there. And then, you know, the TV media, it's all BS. And you have to step back and say, wait a minute, this is not right. There's, you know, I'm a truth seeker. I'm going to have to do my homework, and it starts with yourself. That's the way it should be. And you move. I mean, thank God for the internet. Even though they are in the process of denying people access to the truth and information. Prior to the internet, there were basically these big corporations like CBS and CNN and all these guys, New York Times, Washington Post, and they were the disseminators of information and so-called truth. And they have turned out to be the fake news. They're basically mouthpieces for the establishment that's doing all these horrible things, including the trafficking and abusing of children. We have to realize that this whole power structure is corrupt and abusive. A lot of people have cognitive dissonance when they, around 9/11, people have a hard time facing the reality that we had neocons in power in Bush and Cheney, etc., along with the Zionists. They're Zionists themselves, half of them that were in the 9/11 neocon group that did pulled off 9/11, half of them are dual citizens, loyal to Israel, and then you have the Israel, the Greater Israel Project, and that was really what 9/11 was, where they killed 3,000 people, and a lot of people can't face the reality about that, but that tells you, if we have a government that's willing to sacrifice 3,000 people so that they can then declare war on the Muslims, and have a war against on terror. It's a worldwide war of terror being delivered. I mean, General Wesley Clark actually got a memo, had access to a memo on one of his visits to the Pentagon, and went on and told that there's a plan in place, 7 countries in 5 years. During the Bush regime, and they are still working on Iran. That's the last one that they haven't basically done a changeover in government.
And it doesn't benefit the U.S. at all. Like any of these wars, it's benefiting Israel.
Right.
So like,
the United States fights wars for Israel. That's what it is, and that's why. When they took out the general a week ago or so from Iran, the top general, it's basically engulfing the United States and the Western nations in another war. But this time it's against, all the other countries on this list of 7 are much smaller and less powerful with much less powerful allies. They still haven't quite, pretty much almost destroyed Syria, the little country of Syria, and they're still working on it. I mean, Trump says he's going to take their troops home, and he doesn't. He puts more there. And then, of course, what just happened in Iraq with the Iranian general. They haven't gotten to Iran yet, and that's the last on this list of 7. So that's what it is. It's regime changes for the oil companies or the Greater Israel Project so that the borders of Israel are expanded and Palestinians are completely genocided because that's the process going on there. The world just watches passively Israel, just annihilate. These poor people that have been there, and they're the Semites, by the way. This whole biblical thing of going back and reclaiming your land and all this. 95% of the population of Israel are Ashkenazi Jews from Eastern Europe and Russia. That's where they come from. Their ancestors never set one foot in the Middle East. So the whole concept of a state of Israel, a Jewish state, is founded on lies. That's why we had World War I. That's why we had World War II.
And this ridiculous
for the founding of Israel by the Rothschild family. I wrote a whole chapter on the Rothschilds, too.
this ridiculous notion that they're like God's chosen people and, you know, they were given this land and all this. I mean, I don't know. It's, I mean, again, for me, like, you know, I just kind of was forced to study, like, abusive relationships, like, really early, you know, when I was, you know, young, just from what I was experiencing from, you know, like, everybody around me, and I just really never expected it to turn into this, giant version of the same thing, you know, and I just kind of feel like, I mean, like, other people could have done what I did, you know, decades ago and just, you know, learn these things because it was really, like, in front of everyone's face. But, you know, I was particularly kind of getting, I guess, a lot of the brunt of what was going on. So I was completely determined to get to the bottom of things and figure everything out, you know. And I don't know, I mean, you know, the people really do perpetuate and allow so much of what is happening, you know, and what, you know, what their so-called leaders do. And I mean, I don't know, if people don't really start rising up, I mean, it could, I mean, I don't see how it's not going to get really bad.
Yeah, well,
I mean, not that
it's
not already.
The positive is that more and more people every day are waking up and getting it. They realize that everything is lies and the corruption is so deep. And yeah, we have wars, we have all the horror of pedophilia, and it's the system of our government that's behind it. So people are getting it. You know, that's the good news. There are more and more people on this earth that are becoming aware and waking up. And of course, the next step will be, well, I think it does have to get worse, unfortunately. And there is a plan in place, as we kind of alluded to already, with you know, trying to make a war with Iran. Because when you have a war with Iran, obviously you're having a war with the powers of the East that include Russia and China. So we're talking about, you know, lots of nuclear arms possibly exchanged in a end of the world war. So people are waking up and they're realizing that we need to do something. And my view is that we need to have truth and reconciliation commissions that get to the bottom line, where we basically get the information from the lower levels in order to get to the top, and then hold them accountable for the first time in human history.
Yeah.
Because they've managed to get away with it forever, thousands of years now, really. So, you know, it does have to get worse, unfortunately, before people do, enough people, where we reach critical mass. And enough people demand, you know, major change and, like I say, truth and reconciliation and holding those accountable for all these atrocities. It's going to have to, there is the plan that they're going to go for war and on a mass scale and crash the economy. It's like they've been kicking the can down the road to our House of Cards economy, and it's going to crash. But they're going to time it with war. And so, yeah, we're I believe, probably headed for some pretty dark times in the future. And as it gets dark, I hope that, you know, that's going to mobilize the populations of this earth to say enough is enough. We're not going to take it anymore. So,
do you think... that this country, I guess, you know, Trump, I hate to even say the guy's name because I just don't like giving him any more attention than he, you know, like
yeah.
He already gets. I mean, but like, do you think that this country is going to really you know, poke Iran and really try to provoke them. I mean, you know, they admitted to, you know, mistakenly shooting down this plane, you know, because they're so afraid of, you know, the U.S. attacking them, you know, which is kind of understandable. But, I mean, that's what they had said, which makes, you know, some sense. So do you think that's what's going to happen? Like,
They've been trying. I mean, you recall the incidents from last year. I think it was the summer, July, August, right in there. They were doing those ships in the Gulf, and they were saying that these attacks, these fires on the ships were caused by Iran. I mean, they're doing all these false flags to provoke Iran into some kind of move that will then be justification to declare war. And that's been their MO. I mean, how did we get into the Vietnam War? Well, the Gulf of Tonkin incident, where basically they said that they were a naval ship, U.S. naval ship, was fired upon. No, it didn't happen. But that's how they started the Vietnam War. And we can go basically trace history back all the way. And every war basically is started by a false flag, blaming the enemy, so that you can then declare war on them. Nothing is accurate or true in our history. So,
People need to realize that we live in a literally death economics. Colonel Lawrence Wilkerson said it in an interview, I think it was last week, you know, like, you know, just, and I get so glad when people just say it, you know, that, you know, I mean, this country is all about war. I mean, we've been in it for almost 20 years. Like, what kind of a population tolerates, you know, war for that long? And, I mean, like, if things are not getting better, they're getting worse. And, the, you know, the so-called terrorists, you know, Al-Qaeda, ISIS, all of these people are actually getting stronger.
Well, that's because they're creations of the U.S.
Right.
You know, they're our proxy ally, the U.S. government's secret proxy ally. War is the United States. I think out of all the years that the United States has been in existence, starting with 1776 and the Declaration of Independence, the U.S. has been at war, I think, 93-94% of the time. So, and we are in a permanent global war economy. We have the military-industrial complex that President Eisenhower, back in January 61, warned America about, saying that, you know, these are the threats to our freedom in the future. And, of course, the population didn't really heed what he had to say at that time. Because the rest is history. They got rid of John F. Kennedy, the last good president, that wasn't completely controlled because he was planning to basically get us out of Vietnam, taking all the military that we did have there. He was bringing them back. He also basically was saying, okay, Federal Reserve, that's not federal at all, you private Rothschild bank. I'm going to have the U.S. Treasury, which is how the Constitution structured it, be responsible for the money supply, take it out of the private banking hands. And that was his death declaration, basically. Once he said that, the powers that should not be took over. And, of course, they've owned every president since. So, you know, we have a history of this total oppression, total lies, and world control by a handful of oligarchs, lawlessly, you know, committing all kinds of human atrocities and getting away with it. Time to stop.
So again, recently, you know, there was an interview with the whistleblower for Cambridge Analytica and the creators of that documentary, The Great Hack, you know, and, you know, how they're using the data to manipulate, you know, like, I mean, I'm, you know, I don't want to call it like this, you know, MK Ultra type stuff, but I mean, it is used to manipulate the public and influence elections. Like they were saying how, like, Facebook and, you know, because, like, Facebook allows, of course, the psychos to, I just call them psychos because, you know, I just like to call it what it is. Like, I don't call Trump or any, I don't call them President Trump like people do. I would never call this guy, like, you know, President Trump. But anyway, you know, how, like, they're, you know, rich companies are, you know, they're allowed to lie, basically, on Facebook. Facebook allows them to do these things, and how that helped to get Trump elected and all of these things. And, you know, again, I don't know, like, I just keep going back to my, you know, like, the macro of the micro that, like, was in everyone's face. Like, that's what, like, literally kind of blows my mind is how people, they are the ones that do the things, like, they're carrying out the behaviors, and they are completely unconscious to it. Like, that's what really, really worries me, and, like, because, you know, I mean, to this day, I hear people just, you know, like, things that I've heard people say for decades, like, I still hear them say things today, like, about child abuse and, like, you know, just kind of get over it and all of these things. Like, when it comes to children being abused, there's just this, like, I don't know, like, it's not important, like, children don't matter. But yet, you know, the GM workers, like, they can complain and be interviewed about the working conditions at GM and, you know, the Uber workers and the, you know, the people being affected by the water being contaminated in Flint, Michigan and the BP oil spill. And, you know, there's all of these examples of, like, what I just call the mass abusive relationship, you know, that, like, to me, I, you know, like, child abuse and the abusive family were just the scaled down, clear warning sign for decades that people just normalized and ignored and excused, and like, people are so unconsciously passing the bill and, like, in on it, passing the bill down to, you know, children. It's, I don't know, it's just like this, this illness, like, that people are just going deeper and deeper into, like, a mental illness by passing the bill down to the people that they should be raising and cultivating, who would have then been, like, the immune system to stop the sociopaths, but people protected the sociopaths at the expense of the healthy, truth-telling, vulnerable people. Like, being vulnerable and innocent is literally a crime. And being a truth-teller and a whistleblower is, like, a crime. That's how bad it is.
Well, every scandal, every pedophilia scandal, the children are never listened to. They're always disbelieved. And the whistleblowers, the adult whistleblowers that are trying to get the truth out, are also persecuted. I think that's just the history of humankind, that the forward thinkers that are trying to liberate the masses and you know, make conditions better for humans, oftentimes suffer because the controllers cannot tolerate such people having influence on a lot of other people that they're afraid. See, this divide and conquering has been their MO for staying in power for the millenniums. As long as you can basically get one group pitted against another, whether it's like the Republicans against it, I'm so tired of this. Liberal versus the conservative, and on and on.
I know.
It's all bullshit because they all represent, they click their heels to the same power structure basically pays for both of them. So, you know, got to get past the divide and conquer, and you know, it's tough. I'm working on a chapter right now. Britain, we don't hear that much about it, but have you heard, I'm just curious what you've heard as an American, have you heard of Asian grooming gangs that are raping white girls in Britain? Have you heard about that?
No. See, this
okay.
is like really, I mean, you know, see, I just, you know, I just want to, again, like, stop to pause and reinforce, the, you know, what I was saying before, that we live in death economics. I mean, this is real. Profiting off of misery, endless war, criminalized. I mean, it's, I mean, and I knew all of this stuff literally since the 70s. I mean, I so again, like, continue.
Okay. Yeah, it's a Rothschild-controlled private banking world that basically, through usury, they have us all as debtor slaves. That's how the control mechanism works. And then they pump us with all this disinformation and propaganda and lies to keep us from seeing the truth. Okay, I'm working on a chapter right now about Britain. They, since really the mid-70s, there are, and okay, first of all, I will say this. There are a typical MO, modus operandi, of a pedophile is to target a potential victim by befriending them, by as an adult, by gaining their trust, giving them gifts, pretending that they care about them, listen to them, empathize with them. I mean,
yeah.
I wrote the grooming chapter, basically, with the Penn State coach, Sandusky. And that's how groomers operate. They befriend the family, the parents, and then use their, quote, fame or power to then abuse the child, you know, behind closed doors, or in Sandusky's case, in the shower rooms of the Penn State facility, and then have Coach Joe Paterno look the other way for a few decades.
That's how the priests did it, too. The priests in the church did it that way.
Same deal. Exactly, yeah. What we have in Britain, from really starting in the mid-70s, there's a 1975 newspaper article about, it was actually a statutory rape case of a 15-year-old girl, white girl, in England, who went to a home in Rotherham, which is basically in the Yorkshire area of northern England. There's quite a large percentage, I think one-fifth of the population of Rotherham is of Pakistan. They are Pakistani, British Pakistani population. And there are 1.17 million of them in Britain, which is the largest Pakistani population in Europe. And one of the largest outside of Pakistan, which is also the fifth largest population nation behind Indonesia. They've been coming over. They're from mostly the Kashmir area, which is the most militarized zone in the world because of the conflict between the nuclear powers of India and Pakistan. Over this, up there in the Himalayas, in the very north of the Indian subcontinent. And so it's a very Muslim, basically old school, very traditional, and they're very secular. And anyway, they've come over to Britain, 1.17 million of them in the last 50, 60 years. And okay, the situation is this. They have a lot of businesses at night in all of these northern towns where they have a rather sizable population. And they have the, basically the takeout businesses are owned by the Pakistani British. And the taxis and the fast foods, all of that. And so they became very active at night, basically befriending white girls. A lot of times, like the typical, every scandal basically preys upon the care homes. The ones that don't have parents, okay? They're the most vulnerable population on the earth, kids without parents that are in the system. And in Britain, they have a very aggressive, behind closed doors, secret family court system. Horrible. The parents can't even go to the press and tell the truth. So they're stealing the kids, young kids, away from the parents in England. I mean, it happens in America too. I'm a voice of experience because I represented children in the children's court in Los Angeles. And it's they don't make decisions for the kids' well-being, I'll tell you that much. But anyway, so, yes, there are these supposed groups of, there are predators, sexual predators out there that groom young, vulnerable children and then take advantage of them. Okay. Now, they come in all shapes, all colors, all types, racially, ethnically. But what has happened in Britain is that as of 2011, the Times of London, it is a Rupert Murdoch publication, one of the largest newspapers in London and Britain, the Times, and they came out with an article on January 5th, 2011. And it's basically was the, Britain had, this phenomenon had been going on where there are these gangs, these grooming gangs that allegedly go befriend the white girls and, you know, fellow Asian girls as well, and even boys, but mostly girls. It's the VIPs up there as ministers and MPs in Britain that go after the boys. They're homosexual pedophiles. And these gangs members are not even pedophiles, but they are having sex with girls as young as 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Okay. Now, but they, as I said, they come in all shapes, all colors, all that. As of 2011, this article came out in the Times. From 1975 to 2011, 36 years, and basically barely a word was spoken by the media. They allowed this condition where in the northern towns, there were these grooming gangs going on, and nobody said anything. And the councils, all the governing councils of all the towns and cities of Britain were basically in cahoots. They just let it. They say, here's the rationalization that they have given. As of 2001, you know, with 9/11, they started making all these draconian laws where you can't say nasty things about the Muslims. So basically the age of political correctness that now has corrupted our university system and all of this, where you can't, you know, free speech is pretty much done, First Amendment. But anyway, they claim that these gangs have been grooming these white, targeting white girls. No, they do both. But, you know, as far as they're targeting girls at night, okay? And there are these gangs. I'm not denying that there aren't children being abused this way. They are. However, what they've done as of 2011 is that they've declared open season now on saying that the entire, what it comes down to is basically a character assassination smearing all 1.17 million British Pakistanis, Muslims, as being not only terrorists now, that's the stereotype that a lot of Western nations, people in those countries have, of basically anybody who's darker skinned that happens to come from a Muslim country, they're terrorists. That's the stereotype. Well, now in Britain, they're also rapists, okay? What the press has done is that they focus on every case in Britain, England mostly, not the other countries within Britain, except England, where mostly the British Pakistani population live. And they focus on every case that's involved and blame it on the British Pakistani population of these grooming gangs. When there are white grooming gangs, there are groups from other countries, Kosovo, there are a whole bunch. I can't even think of the countries involved, but there's African countries, Nigeria, Somalia, that are involved in this, and plenty of white, you know, groups. Oh, and by the way, they have this very nebulous definition of grooming gang. They invented the term, basically. As of this January 5th article, the Times of London invented this term called Asian group grooming gang, when, in fact, every ethnicity, and they define it by two or more people that are in cahoots together working to groom targeted children for sexual purposes, and then putting them to work, using them basically as sex slaves and making money off them, as well as sexually abusing them themselves. So they invented a special model, they call it, of child sexual exploitation. The Asian grooming gangs. They put it on the map. When in fact, there's basically, you can take two ethnically tied people that are both groomers working together to abuse children in every ethnicity. But what they did in Britain is to focus on the British Pakistani grooming gangs and say, see what these people are doing? To make it like basically they are blaspheming all British Pakistanis and building a case all out of proportion. They lied, they do this quote study that's supposed to be scientific, the Quilliam Foundation, which is basically financed by Saudi Arabia, you know, oligarchs and Egypt and people that are inspiring the racist white supremacy organizations, the neocons, Republicans, and the British government financed this Quilliam Foundation to do this paper that says 84% of all grooming gangs are Asians, i.e. these British Pakistanis. And it's total lies. It's total lies. There are Pakistanis that do grooming, but then there are every ethnicity, there's two or more of each ethnicity that are involved in grooming in Britain, okay? But they've honed in on this and made it like, oh, it's those British Pakistanis, those Muslims. So, basically, what that does is it jacks up all the white supremacists into believing, oh yeah, let's go get those Muslims. We hate the Muslims. Let's kill them because they're going to kill us. And they're already defiling all our white daughters. You know, it's a horrible situation. And so there's so much racial tension. And that's exactly the agenda that the planetary controller bloodlines are doing. They're pitting one group against another, and they want racial wars, they want religious wars. They've been trying to do it in America, whites versus the blacks, and then the Muslims versus the Christians. I mean, it's all over. And why do you think they have all these Middle Eastern wars in North Africa where they do all these regime change wars, and then they have this mass migration? It's all basically the oligarchs that have gotten together and decided, the globalists that are out for one world government, and they're going to destroy Western Europe and North America by mass migration of Muslims, many of whom do not integrate into the native cultures in Britain. And so they basically use the British Pakistanis as scapegoats to take away the focus of the VIP government ministers and MPs diddling little kids. There's been one scandal after the next. I've already covered all the British scandals. They have the ones in Northern Ireland. They have ones in Scotland. They have the in Islington, North London also. Lambeth, they have one scandal after the next involving the VIPs, and they close down all the police investigations, they destroy evidence, and they cover everything up. And so what has happened is they have used the scapegoat of British Pakistani grooming gangs that they invented. Yes, there are people of this ethnicity doing the grooming, and there are victims being victimized. I'm not denying that. But what they've done is they've blown it all out of proportion so that the focus is on these, quote, you know, British Pakistani Muslims as the bad guys, when to take the heat off the VIPs that are in power that have historically been doing these horrible things to children that are part of the whole mass trafficking system. They don't want the truth. What did they do to a man who came out and said, this is like in 2014, 2015, I think it was, he came out and was saying that, yes, he's seen MPs murder children in his abuse. They put him in jail for 19 years. They say that he made everything up, and then they have a case where they have the superstar singer, and I can't remember his name, but anyway, they have a case where he goes against BBC, so they don't cover the arrest of celebrities. People in power. So basically, they can't cover that, otherwise they'll be sued up the yin-yang. And there's pushback, basically, that's been going on in Britain, and basically, as Britain goes, because it's the epicenter of pedophilia of the whole world, so goes the rest of the world. So there's this pushback by those in power to basically make sure that their pedophilia is not covered. It's not exposed. And they go after this whole group of people, 1.17 million, and they use British Pakistani thinking tank, a think tank, the Quilliam Foundation. They finance this think tank to come out with the lies about these grooming gangs, just to take the heat off the VIP, these ugly white power assholes from doing all this stuff to kids. And that's the chapter that I'm finishing up now. They basically, there's pushback in that they put people in jail. I believe this person that's spending 19 years in jail, there's a, in the Hampstead case, there's a campaigner that they put in jail for 9 years, Sabina McNeil, is doing 9 years there for being a campaigner for justice for the Hampstead kids. So they're going after the truth tellers, the whistleblowers, and they're putting them in jail, and they're destroying evidence, and it's involving major governments. Serco Corporation. This is a major private contractor that's in every aspect of the spy business, of the security business. They're part in transportation business, and they are a huge part. They have organized crime that's involved. I mean, one of the first questions was, who's behind it? Well, it's the government and these oligarchs. It's the media, Murdoch and Fox and the Times and all of this. They're all part of it because they played a huge part.
And Israel.
Everything is for Israel. And of course, Israel is the center of the organ trafficking of the world. I wrote an article about that a couple of years ago. And then the charity organization, Serco, though, is a huge one is part of this whole trafficking of children around the world. That's the whole structure. And because they got the media completely, and that's why they're trying to censor everything on the internet so that people don't have access to the truth. Because there's four or five oligarchs that control the CNNs and the CBS and all the major corporations, news outlets. So they're going after, using Facebook and Gestapo, Google Gestapo and all of that. They're going after the censoring, and they twist things around. And that's the nature of every pedophile scandal, is that they twist the truth around so that they just do blackouts, media blackouts. They have 100 with the Dunblane massacre, which is the killer of that of 16 kids in a school in Scotland back in 1996. They have a 100-year rule where you can't get information as to what really happened for 100 years. That's because there were some VIP pedophiles involved in that. Every single one of these scandals, there's VIPs involved. So in order to protect the elite class that's doing all these horrible things on the earth, they make sure that the people, the public, don't get access to the truth. Well, I'm taking that in my own hands. In the last 2.5+ years, I've been working on this book. I expect that I will be complete done. Probably I'm shooting for August of this year. I have about 8 chapters left. I will cover the Australian scandals. I'll cover the rest of Europe, which is huge too.
When you say Australian scandal, what are you referring to?
Well, recently, last year, they locked up the Vatican treasurer, George Pell, Cardinal Pell. P-E-L-L.
Right.
He got extradited back from Rome to Australia, and he was put on trial in Australia last year, and he's doing some serious time. I forgot how many years, 6 years, I think, which is really, for what he did, nothing really. But he's the highest person up in Roman Catholics, the highest, because he was the right-hand man of the Pope, and he's doing time for pedophilia. So that is some kind of breakthrough, because generally all the VIP, all the people in power, including Epstein, they protect, okay? So there is progress, at least in Australia. They have pedophilia there. It's terrible. It's very, very bad.
Have you ever heard of Fiona Barnett?
Oh, yeah. She was a mind control sex slave. Nixon did her, and so did Billy Graham. She's quite a whistleblower, she's tells it like it is. She's a, I have total respect for that woman. Major truth teller.
Yeah, I was almost going to interview her, but, you know, I think she's kind of like a little bit on the DL lately. And Ronald Bernard would have been another one that I would like to interview.
Yeah, the banker, the Dutch banker. He tells the truth about what the elite are doing as far as their sexual depravity and perversions.
They describe Fiona Barnett. She actually sent me her book. I have it on my laptop. I was reading it. Her and Ronald Bernard, they talk about, like, Fiona talk, it's on YouTube. People can look it up. I mean, it used to be anyway. And she describes, like, really horrific child sacrifices, and the people involved. And I mean, holy moly.
Yeah, she testified at the International Tribunal for Natural Justice last year, I think in 2019, or maybe 2018, I'm not even sure now. But yeah, she did about an hour and a half testimony, and then has this book out too. Yeah, that tells you basically, because it was involved with the CIA and the intelligence agencies of the world, where she was trafficked. She went to Bohemian Grove and I think was abused there by Billy Graham, I believe. And Nixon was in Australia and abused her at a military airport. And of course, there are these mind-controlled sex slaves that they do basically, they do torture. When they're 3 years old, they torture them and have sex with them split their mind into dissociative disorder, where one personality doesn't know what the other personality is doing. And that way they're able to train from a very early age of three, a brainwashed slave for the purposes of assassination. They're making super soldiers out of this method, or sex slaves, or spies, and they've been doing this since the 1950s. You know, Operation Paperclip, they brought over Mengele from the concentration camps of Germany, and he headed, along with a few other CIA scientists, this whole MKUltra program, and they never stopped. They have underground military installations all over America and Britain, all over the world, where they are doing this mind control still, even though they made lies and said that, no, it ended as of 1971 or 2 or something like that. But no, the mind control, and they also are doing psychotronic weaponry. They've been doing this for a long time now, too, where they use brainwave technology, electromagnetic waves to do mind control, mass mind control. They have psychotronic warfare where they're able to implant thoughts into people's heads and torture their minds and radiate them into death. They have psychotronic machines that can cause people heart attacks that are untraceable, so that the coroner cannot figure out that this was a murder, not a heart attack by natural cause. So they're doing a lot of things. They target people. They call it target individuals, where they do gang stalking. These are like the CIA, all the intelligence services are part of this whole thing. The military intelligence, they do horrible things to people. I get letters from people all the time about this stuff. It's very terrible. And that's something I'll probably work on next after I expose the pedophilia operations around the world.
I kind of, I'm interviewing you because you're saying a lot of the things that I felt already, again, since, you know, for decades now, and how, because, you know, I mean, I spent my whole life studying the abusive family system and abusive relationships. And I feel like that was already happening, you know, again, within the family. And, you know, parents pretty much are kind of working for the system and then teaching and raising their kids to work for the system. I mean, maybe it was, you know, not to the extreme that you're talking about, like this deliberate fracturing of you know, but again, I do believe that it definitely has been and does, you know, go on in families, because I believe it was Fiona Barnett's parents, I think, who got her into doing that.
Yeah, there's Illuminati families where it's been generations, multi-generations that go back centuries, actually, where they've been doing the torture and the sexual abuse at a very early age. They have kids, and this also was in the Hampstead 2 scandal, where the father grabs the child's hand holding the knife and actually slits the throat of the babies. They drain the blood, drink the blood, eat the organs. They cook the meat off the babies. But they do these rituals. Illuminati families, and you can bet that the bloodline families of the royal family, quote, from England / Germany, because they're Nazis, actually. They have a whole history of being Nazis. By the way, I'm finally going to be finishing Britain. I've been working on Britain for the last, I would say, year and a half, doing one chapter. I mean, I have a total of 15 chapters on this little this little island nation called Britain. Like I say, it's the epicenter of the world for pedophilia. So my final chapter is the Windsor family, basically the German Gupta Sack family, from Germany. That's going to be my final British chapter on pedophilia, because they are so steeped into pedophilia. Many of the family members, the male members, are pedophiles. Who was Charles's best friend, Prince Charles? Jimmy Savile.
Yeah, yeah.
British history's biggest pedophile,
jeez.
Jimmy Savile. He was the mentor of Charles. He brought Jimmy to counsel himself and his wife, that they murdered, by the way, Diana, when they were having their marital problems. The mentor brought in to counsel them was Jimmy Savile, who went to the prime minister's house every holiday Christmas time under Margaret Thatcher for 11 years. Jimmy Savile, who was knighted by the Pope. Jimmy Savile, who went to Israel.
No, that's right.
Basically counseled the Knesset and the Prime Minister of Israel on how to handle those Muslim enemies. He was an intelligence operative. He was working for MI5, and he was the procurer of children for the royal family and for the MPs and all of these types.
Who was that other really kind of, you know, disgusting, big, fat guy, like some higher up?
Cyril Smith, another knight. I will say that every person knighted by Queen Elizabeth is a pedophile. But I'll tell you, I would go this far. I would say probably the majority of people that Queen Elizabeth knights are pedophiles. I will say that. That's Cyril Smith, who was an MP, Liberal Democrat MP, very powerful for, 30, 40 years. He was doing these terrible things to kids. And everybody knew about it. The CIA, I mean, the MI5, they covered it up for him. And, you know, but yeah, they all know, all the inside people know about these high-profile pedophiles. But they wait till they're dead before any information comes out.
We
got to stop that.
Exactly.
We have to get them while they're still alive.
Why are people such cowards? Like, I don't understand why grown people are such cowards. I mean, they're literally willing to sacrifice children. I mean, again, you know, this is like, you know, what I've been saying for like a long time. I mean, on some level, it's like so many people are in on it, you know. I mean, even in Hollywood, for God's sake, a lot of the, you know, the actors knew, you know, what's that, the documentary about Corey.
Yeah.
Corey Feldman and, yeah, like they talk about that. And
Hollywood is infested with Luciferian blood drinking, adrenochrome types doing their pedophilia. I had a whole chapter on Hollywood. They have the elite basically comprised of the politicians, comprised of royalty, comprised of entertainers, top entertainers, and this is the elite class that's part of this whole operation around the world of human trafficking.
They're literally feeding off of us, and sure. The people are helping. What it makes me so angry that the people are not even on their own side. Like, they're literally, I mean, you know, I just was a witness to this stuff. It's like people don't know how, they're so, I don't know, wired, conditioned, programmed at, you know, early ages to be, you know, to be slaves, to just function, you know, at a low level, you know, have a job, kids, whatever, and, you know, and be at their own expense. And I mean, I feel like it was happening to me early on, and I just like fought it, boy. I mean, I know it's like, I don't want to sound like it's some conspiracy theorist, but I felt like I was waking up from some kind of a botched like operation that they're trying to program that they're trying to perform on you. Because they do, they, this is like one thing that is for absolute certain. And you know, people still do it today. They make your body's healthy responses like a pathology, and while making dysfunction and abuse normal. You know, so it's just like there's like a shifting going on. And they do. People are just not paying attention. They're not, you know, seeing what they're doing. Like, they're literally extracting energy and health from the most vulnerable, you know, powerless people who have no money to feed the sociopaths that are like controlling the whole world.
Yeah.
And the people are literally like the ones that were doing it. I mean, that was my experience. And they still don't get it. They still, people around me don't get it, but
I think that there are people waking up every day and they are getting it. They, you can only be told a lie so many times that some people are getting it and waking up, and those are the people that we need to unify with. And then there will be those that never get it, and you just have to kind of leave them alone because they're not going to get it. You're wasting all your time and energy on them. So, you know, I'm encouraged that people are getting it. But we do have to unite. We have to unite as a human species.
Absolutely.
We cannot allow ourselves to be divided and conquered and ruled and killed. I believe that there's a human genocide that's happening here. 5G is radiating us to death. And now that's in place, and they've been poisoning the foods, making it dead for many, many years with all the chemicals and fluoride and the water supply.
That's what I mean.
They've been going after us for a long time.
Right. If the people don't value their own health, exactly. Like, see, that's what I mean. Like, I just feel like it's the behavior of the people that allows the abusers to do what they do, you know.
Well, ignorance is not bliss, and we just need to keep telling the truth, and those that are receptive to it will heed, and those that don't, we move on. So anyway, I think I'm about talked out now.
Yeah. So just say what. So is your website American Empire Exposed?
That's what I call it. You can get there by empireexposed.blogspot.com. Again, my book that you can get on Amazon, it's still selling by the chapter, and many chapters are still in the bestsellers list under the category of child advocacy. And it is Pedophilia and Empire, semicolon, Satan, Sodomy, and the Deep State, and empireexposed.blogspot.com. You know, it's, yeah, and I'll be done this year. Yes, I will be done this year. Finally, it'll be over 3 years of hard labor to basically. It's my wake up call for the world to because, and I'm known for. I have chapters with over 500 footnotes in the chapters. So when you're going after the controllers of the earth who are doing these horrible things to kids, you better have documentation that's strong backing it up. So that's a big part of the process of getting it done is just making sure that I have all my T's crossed. But yeah, I'm known for all that documentation because you have to back it up.
Thank you. And this is why I like talking to you, because you talk about, you know, children and child abuse. And I get tired of hearing of, you know, the adults complaining about the people in power, and when they should be really talking more about child abuse. So to me, that's like a kind of a glaring sign that we have a long way to go, I think, unfortunately. So thank you, Joachim Hagopian. I say it
thank
right.
Thank you, Kat.
Okay.
Hagopian, pretty close.
Yeah. Okay, I usually do say it that way, though. Okay.
Okay.
We'll do this again soon, I hope.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Peace.
Bye.
Bye.